This is a great book called On Writing by Charles Bukowski. A tremendous book, and I'm going to share some of the letters which this book contains so that you see who he was as a writer. This book, as I've said in another video, is more about his approach to the life of being a writer and putting writing at the forefront of our life rather than a book about craft. The book is a series of letters that have been edited by Abel Debritto. This example I've got is by Canongate, and I'll put a link to it and an affiliate link in the description so that if you want to get a copy yourself, you can benefit from a deep dive into the whole book. I'm just going to read a few sections from the book On Writing by Charles Bukowski. This one from 1947 is a short letter to one of the editors of a poetry magazine, a man called Whit Burnett. Thank you for the note. I don't think I could do a novel. I haven't the urge, though I have thought about it, and someday I might try it. Blessed Factotum would be the title, and it would be about the low-class working man, about factories and cities and courage and ugliness and drunkenness. I don't think if I wrote it any now, it would be any good, though I would have to get properly worked up. Besides, I have so many personal worries right now that I'm in no shape to look into a mirror, let alone run off a book. I am, however, surprised and pleased with your interest. I haven't any other pen sketches without stories right now. Matrix took the only one I did that way. The world has had little Charles pretty much by the balls of late, and there isn't much writer left with. So hearing from you was damned lovely. Some of his letters are illustrated with drawings and sketches. Here's a letter from March 1961 to his editor, John Webb. What bothers me is when I read about the old Paris groups or someone who knew somebody in the old days. They did it then too, the names of old and now. I think Hemingway is writing a book about it now. But in spite of it all, I can't buy it. I can't stand writers or editors or anybody who wants to talk art. For 3 years, I lived in a Skid Row hotel before my hemorrhage, and I got drunk every night with an ex-con, the hotel maid, an Indian, and a gal who looked like she wore a wig but didn't, and three or four drifters. Nobody knew Shostakovich from Shelley Winters, and we didn't give a damn. The main thing was sending runners out for liquor when we ran dry. We'd start low on the line with our worst runner, and if he failed, you must understand, most of the time there was little or no money. And if he failed, we'd go a little deeper with our next best man. I guess it's bragging, but I was top dog. And when the last one staggered through the door, pale and shamed, Bukowski would rise with an invective, don his ragged cloak, and stroll with anger and assurance into the night, down to Dick's liquor store. From April 1961 to John Corrington. It's evident that many of our present-day editors still go by thumb of rulebook on what has preceded them. The sanctuary of the rule means nothing to the pure creator. There is an excuse for poor creation if we are dithered by camouflage or wine come down through staring eyes, but there isn't any excuse for a creation crippled by directives of school and fashion, or the valedictorian prayer book that says, form, 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 put it in a cage. Let's allow ourselves, as writers, space and error, hysteria and grief. Let's not round the edge until we have a ball that rolls neatly away like a trick. Things happen. The priest gets shot in the john. Hornets blow heroin without arrest. They take down your number. Your wife runs off with an idiot who's never read Kafka. The crushed cat, its guts gluing its skull to the pavement, is passed by traffic for hours. Flowers grow in the smoke. Children die at 9 and 97. Flies are smashed from screens. The history is form of evident. I am the last to say we can start with zero, but let's get out of 8 and 9 and upward into 11. We may repeat, as if we have been doing, about what is true and have, I suppose, been doing it quite well. But I'd like to see us scream a little more hysterically, if we are men enough, about the untrue also and the uninformed and the never to be formed. Really, we must let the candle burn. Pour gasoline on it, if necessary. The sense of the ordinary is always ordinary, but there are screams from windows too. An artistic hysteria engendered out of breathing in the necropolis. Sometimes when the music stops and leaves us four walls of rubber or glass or stone, or worse, no walls at all, poor and freezing in the Atlanta of the heart. To concentrate on form and logic, the turning of the phrase seems imbecility in the midst of the madness. A little later the same year, to John Webb. Heard some of my poems read on the radio the other night. I wouldn't have known, but Jory Sherman, who keeps up with such, told me over the phone, so I got drunk and I listened. Very odd to hear your own words coming back through speaker of radio that has told you news reports, freeway jams, played Beethoven and professional football games. One poem, the first of 15, was the Roses poem in Outsider. He also read parts of my letter regarding editors and poetry readings and critics or something like that, and had the audience at times laughing, as did a couple of the poems. So I didn't feel so bad, but when I got up to get another beer, I stepped on a 3-inch piece of glass on the floor. My place is a mess. And glass went straight up into my heel, and I yanked it out and bled for a couple of hours. I limped around for a week, and then one day woke up covered with sweat, burning hot, vomiting. For a while I thought it was hangover, but after a while decided it was not, and drove down Hollywood Boulevard to some Dr. Landers and got a shot. Got back, opened a beer, and immediately stepped on another piece of glass. Jesus, I read in Outsider that the early Henry Miller made carbons of his work and shipped it to people. To me, this is inconceivable, but suppose Miller thought there weren't any openings for him and he had to make his own. I suppose each man attacks it differently, although I see where Grove issued his Tropic, and now that it is a safe thing, it is falling pretty flat in most quarters. Also, note that Life Mag and others gave it to Hem, pretty good in the ass, which he deserved, having pretty much sold out after his early works, which I always knew, but which I never heard anybody say until after his suicide. Why did they wait? Faulkner is, in essence, much like Hem. The public has swallowed him with one big gulp, and the critics, having something a little more subtle, feel safe and egg them on. But a lot of Faulkner is pure shit. But it's clever shit, cleverly dressed, and when he goes, they will have trouble rubbing him out, because they don't quite understand him, and not understanding him, the dull and vacant parts, the massive italics, they will think this to mean genius. In this one from October 1962, Bukowski is responding to a letter by Felix Stefanil, written in reaction to Bukowski being named Outsider of the Year by the Outsider editors. They have all these concepts and preconcepts of what poetry should be. Mostly they're still in the 19th century. If a poem doesn't look like Lord Byron, then you've got crackers in your bed. The politicians and newspapers talk a lot about freedom, but the moment you begin to apply any, either in life or in the art form, you're in for a sell, ridicule or misunderstanding. I sometimes think when I put that sheet of white paper in the typer, you'll soon be dead. We'll all soon be dead. Now, it may not be too bad being dead, but while you're living, it might be best to live from the source struck inside of you. And if you come to the poem, you're not going to worry too much about writing like Keats or Swinburne or Shelley or acting like Frost. You're not going to worry about spondees, counts, or if the endings rhyme. You want to get it down, hard or crude or otherwise, any way you can truly send it through. The mass, both the actual mass and the artistic mass in the sense of large practicing numbers only, are always far behind, practicing safety not only in the material and economic life, but in the life of the so-called soul. If you wear a straw hat in December, you're dead. If you write a poem that escapes the mass hypnosis of the 19th century slick, soft poesy that they think you write badly because you do not sound right, they want to hear what they have always heard, but they forget that it takes 5 or 6 good men every century to push the thing ahead out of staleness and death. I'm not saying that I am one of these men, but I am sure as hell saying I am not one of the others, which leaves me hanging outside. In 1967, Charles Bukowski unsuccessfully applied for a National Endowment for the Arts Fellowship. This one, a letter from April 1968, to his friend Harold Norse. I'd heard about some of those who were given grants and knew that they were not very much. I mean, as far as talent. Also, some were offered grants who didn't even apply, and some of these refused the grants. I guess they're not as near to starvation and madness as I am. What happened? One wonders about things that occur underground and overground that we know nothing of. I guess the X is chalked on my back. I'm ready for the butcher. The FBI was round the other day, asking my landlord and the neighbours about me. The landlord told me, since I drink with him and his wife, that I've got the pipeline. Think I told you a bigwig interviewed me in a long dark room with a lamp down at the end of the big table. Real Kafka, Nazi style. I was told they didn't like my column, Notes of a Dirty Old Man. I asked, are we to presume that the postal officials are the new critics of literature? Oh, no, no, we didn't mean that. Like hell. Then he told me, if you had stuck to poetry and poetry books, you would have been all right. But this? And he tapped the newspaper in my column and left the rest unspoken. It is the writing itself that simply pisses them. But I'm hardly even obscene. They don't know how to hook me, and we keep shaking hands. But they're waiting for my one slip, and then they're going to step in and break my neck. Meanwhile, they're hoping that I will get paranoid about the whole thing and start jumping at shadows and flush my supplies of luck down the crapper, which I damn well might do. Meanwhile, I tell the few people I know so they can get off me if they wish, and it's amazing. I've told a few and no longer hear from them. Most everybody, I've found out, is some kind of shit deep down. I'm the sift-up redhead being led out of the car on the corner. In 1970, he wrote to his friend Lafayette Young. I have to drink and gamble to get away from this typewriter. Not that I don't love this old machine when it's working right, but knowing when to go to it and knowing when to stay away from it, that's the trick. I really don't want to be a professional writer. I want to write when I want to write, else it's all been wasted. I don't want to sound holy about it. It's not holy. It's more like Popeye the Sailor Man. But Popeye knew when to move. So did Hemingway until he started talking about discipline. Pound also talked about doing one's work. That's shit, but I've been luckier than both of them because I've worked the factories and the slaughterhouses and the park benches, and I know that work and discipline are dirty words. I know what they meant, but for me, it has to be a different game. Guy Williams tried to pump the English department for funds for a reading, Auden getting $2,000, others usually get $300 to $500. Poor Williams, he must have caught a wagon load of shit. The English department didn't want Bukowski. Okay, maybe they're right. I got two D's in English at LA City College. This one, at the end of January 1979, is to John Fante, the author of Ask the Dust. Bukowski writes, thanks for the good letter. It's been a very odd, very strange feeling to get a letter from you. It's been some decades since I first read Ask the Dust. Martin has sent me a Xerox of the novel, and I'm starting in on it again, and it reads as well as ever. Along with Doss's Crime and Punishment and Celine's Journey, it is my favourite novel. Forgive me for not answering sooner, but right now I'm into a great many things. Screenplay, correcting somebody else's screenplay, a short story, and also drinking and playing the horses and fighting with my girlfriend and visiting my daughter, and then feeling bad and feeling good and all the rest of it. Then I lost your letter, and I was so proud of it, and last night I found it. I had been using the back of the envelope to make suggestions on my corrections on this fellow's screenplay and adaptation of my first novel, Post Office. So here it is raining, and I am writing you rapidly because I want to get down to the bank to cash this check so I can make the racetrack tomorrow. Your writing helped my life, gave me real hope that a man could just put the words down and let the emotions ride out. Nobody has done this as well as you have. I'm going to read the book slowly, enjoy it once again, and hope that I can write a reasonable foreword. Mencken has a good eye, among other things, and I think it is time that a talent like yours surfaced again. Even though Black Sparrow is not New York, it has some prestige and a big bang, and such books are more apt to last and be read by other people than the general public, which simply eats up whatever New York feeds them. Great to hear from you, Fante. You are number one all the way. Forgive me for typing. After I finish the book and do the foreword, I will mail it to you for your okay, hopefully. Best to your wife and son. The sky is wet today, and tomorrow the track will be muddy, but I will be thinking of you and the luck that I will have of being able to tell people why Ask the Dust is so good. Thank you. Yes. Here's one from February 1983 to Los Pequeños Glaciers. I don't know exactly how it works. What I mean is, I'm not writing much better now than I was decades ago, when I was starving to death in those small rooms and flop houses and living on park benches, and while I was being nearly murdered in those factories and in the post office. Durability has something to do with it. I've outlived many of the editors who rejected me, and some of the women too. If there's any difference in my writing now, I feel more entertained when I write it. But things happen very quickly. One moment you're a drunken bum fighting with drunken and drugged and insane women in a no-class apartment. And then it seems the next thing you're in Europe and you walk into a hall and there are 2,000 wild people waiting for you to read some poems. Having enough money at the moment allows me to live in this small town, San Pedro, where the people are quite normal and easy and dull and good, and you'd have a hard time finding a writer or a painter or an actor anywhere around. This is where I can live with my three cats and drink almost every night and type until 2 or 3 a.m. And the next day there's the racetrack. That's all I need. And trouble will always find you, or me. There are still good and unhappy moments with the female, but I like the setup. I'm glad I'm not Norman Mailer or Capote or Vidal or Ginsberg reading with The Clash, and I'm glad I'm not The Clash. What I'm getting at is that when luck comes your way, you can't let it swallow you. Getting famous when you're in your 20s is a very difficult thing to overcome. When you get half famous, when you're over 60, it's easier to make adjustments. Old Ez Pound used to say, do your work. And I knew exactly what he meant, even though to me writing is never work, no more than drinking is. And of course I'm drinking now, so that if this gets a little muddled, well, that's my style. In June 1984, Bukowski wrote to A.D. Winans, I think one of the best things that ever happened to me was that I was so long unsuccessful as a writer and had to work for a living until I was 50. It kept me away from other writers and their parlour games and their backbiting and their bitching. And now that I've had some luck, I still intend to absent myself from them. Let them continue their attacks. I will continue my work, which is not something I do to seek immortality or even minor fame. I do it because I must and I will. I feel good most of the time, especially when I'm at this machine, and the words feel more and more as if they're coming out better and better. True or not, right or wrong, I go with it. In December 1985, Bukowski writes to Joyce Fante, widow of his friend, who wrote The Road to Los Angeles and The Wine of Youth. Both of these were published posthumously by Black Sparrow Press in 1985. Bukowski writes, I'm sorry you asked about John's book, and I have sat about for days and some nights wondering how to answer you, and there's no way I can do it but this way. I didn't like it, or the book which followed. You know, there is a way of having rancour with style, and there is a way of indulging bitterness with humour, but both of these books just made me feel very bad. It's all right to ravage if your ravage takes courage, but if it's just ravage for the sake of ravage, well, that's done every day in all of our lives. It happens on the freeways and alleys of our goings and comings and waitings. John was my main influence, along with Celine and Dostoevsky and Sherwood Anderson, and he wrote some of the most feeling and graceful books of our time, but I feel that these latter or earlier works would have been better left unpublished. I could be wrong, of course. I am often wrong. That I was able to meet my hero, if you'll pardon that term, late in his life and under the most painful conditions, was both a very sad and a very great thing for me, and I hope that the few words that I had with John helped him in the middle of that most terrible hell. For it all, I will always remember reading Ask the Dust, which I still consider the finest novel written in all time, a novel which probably saved my life for whatever it is worth. Nobody is ever on top of their game at all times. In fact, few ever get very close. John did, and more than once. You lived with a very bitter man who overcame his bitterness finally with a love that rang and filled and jostled each line into a memorable miracle that said, yes, in spite of no, yes, because of no, which said, yes, yes, yes. and continued to say it even as I met him as he was. There will never be another John Fante. He was a bulldog with heart in hell. And I'm going to share a final letter, this one from July 1991, that was written to his friend John Martin. Read where Henry Miller stopped writing after he became famous, which probably meant he wrote to become famous. I don't understand this. There is nothing more magic and beautiful than lines forming across paper. It's all there. It's all there ever was. No reward is greater than the doing. What comes afterwards is more than secondary. I can't understand any writer who stops writing. It's like taking your heart out and flushing it away with the turds. I'll write to my last goddamn breath, whether anybody thinks it's good or not. The end as the beginning. I was meant to be like this. It's as simple and profound as that. Now, let me stop writing about this so I can write about something else. And that's just a selection of a dozen or so letters from more than 100 in this book, Charles Bukowski, On Writing. The book is about his approach to the writing life rather than having anything to do with the craft of writing. There are hundreds of books on the craft of writing, but in this book, which after all is not written by Charles Bukowski as a book, it's published posthumously by an editor taking a selection from thousands of letters that he wrote. And I hope I've done it justice by sharing with you his sense of the spirit of a writer who had to write. He overcame demons, but he continued to write right up until the end. Charles Bukowski, On Writing.